Hello, and you're welcome to History on the Doorstep. I'm Colm O'Neil.
And I'm Michael McGee.
On today's programme, we're going to investigate the failed uprising of 1803 and have a look at the patriot Robert Emmett.
Apples still grow in November, and blossoms still bloom on each tree. When leaves they're still green in December, it's then that our land will be free. I wander her hills and her valleys, and still through my sorrow I see a land that has never known freedom, and still only her rivers run free. I'll drink to the death of her manhoods, to those men who would rather they died than to live in the cold chains of bondage, to bring back their rights were denied. Oh, where are you now when we need you? What burns where the flame used to be? Are you gone like the snows of last winter? And will only our rivers run free?
Towards the late 18th century, there had been two distinctive rebellions against the powers that be around the globe, and especially the old world ruling order, as could be seen by the American and French revolutions. It was a time of change in patriotism, liberty and freedom, and in no less a place than a small country like Ireland itself. In light of these successes, and in a bid to achieve reform and greater autonomy from Britain, Protestant liberals in Belfast formed the United Irishmen in 1791. Which was an organisation to cross the religious divide, with a membership comprising of Roman Catholics, Presbyterians, Methodists, other Protestant dissenter groups, and even some from the Protestant ascendancy.
With an unlikely alliance with the Catholic resistant group, the Defenders, the United Irishmen, who had also sourced French aid, decided on an arms insurrection against British forces in Ireland. The bottom line being that they wanted to break the connection with England. Of course, history tells us that the uprising of 1798 was a failure, with upwards of 30,000 United Irishmen and civilian deaths, while there was reported to be 2,000 troops and 1,000 loyalist civilian losses.
How sweet is life, but we're crying. How mellow the wine, but we're dry. How fragrant the rosebud that's dying. How gentle the wind, but it sighs. What good is in youth when it's aging? What joy is in eyes that can't see? When there's sorrow in sunshine and flowers, and still only our rivers run free.
Just 5 years later, in 1803, 25-year-old Dublin man Robert Emmett led another failed uprising against English rule in Ireland. To try and understand what happened on one of the most infamous dates in Irish history a bit more, I asked Dr. Patrick Guagan, history lecturer at Trinity College and four-time author including Robert Emmett Alive, about how the 1803 rebellion came about.
Well, the first thing that we have to say is that it follows on from the 1798 rebellion, when the United Irishmen had tried to organise a nationwide rebellion, but because of spies and informers, that rebellion was limited to just three parts of the country. And Robert Emmett, a young man, only 20 years old at the time of that rebellion, he was immediately put in charge of a subcommittee to try and investigate what had gone wrong after the failure of 1798. His older brother, Thomas Addis Emmett, had been in prison, and a lot of the United Irishmen had either been exiled or killed. So Emmett investigated the failure of 1798 and discovered that what had gone wrong was that too many people had known the plans for the rebellion. And therefore he decided that any future rebellion had to rely on absolute secrecy. So that was kind of the background to 1803. Emmett went off to France, tried to enlist French support. But when he came back, he was keen on two things. The first is that there would be absolute secrecy. The second is that the French, who were now being controlled by Napoleon, the French would only be allowed come as allies. So he wanted it to be kind of like the American War of Independence, where it would be Irish people who would rise up first, take control of the country, and only then invite the French to leave, to land. That his fear was that if the French came first, that they would then replace British rule with French rule.
Robert Emmett, who was a young man, suddenly found himself in charge of a group of rebels about to embark into battle. It would have taken a lot of courage and leadership from him, so the question must be asked, if the would-be patriots had held any respect for him even though he was so young, and even more so, what sort of force were they that were bold enough to even take on the might of the British Dublin garrison on the 23rd of July, 1803?
Well, I suppose the answer is that at times he didn't. That when a lot of the people turned up on the day of the rebellion, they discovered that it was this young man, they called him dismissively a boy. And the reason why the rebellion was so small was because a lot of the people who turned up were very disappointed to find. Also, I think sometimes Emmett gets the credit for the rebellion when it should, he himself credited a lot of other people, and really Emmett was only in charge of the Dublin side of the rebellion. The plan is that Thomas Russell would be rising up in the north of Ireland, and that probably you would have had other rebellions in the rest of the country. So Emmett wasn't kind of like the mastermind, the ringleader behind the whole thing, but afterwards everything was associated with him.
And had he much military training at all, or even the troops to know following him, did they have much training?
Well, Emmett himself had absolutely no military training, but when he was on the continent, he studied military textbooks, which, as he discovered on the night of the 23rd of July 1803, wasn't any substitute at all. A lot of the men under him would have either served in the British armies or they were veterans of 1798, so they had a lot of military experience. But the trouble is that he had relied on secrecy so much that by the night of the rebellion, the 2,000 men that he was expecting to turn up didn't materialise, and he was left with about 80, and most of them were drunk.
Altogether, the rebellion failed and it collapsed very quickly. On realising the inadequate support he had and the state his followers proved to be, Emmett attempted to disperse the rabble. However, he was ignored and a large-scale riot ensued in the Thomas Street area of Dublin. It was here where the fate of Robert Emmett as leader of this short-lived uprising was sealed.
The rioters, in their uncontrolled frenzy, came upon the Lord Chief Justice of Ireland, Lord Kilwarden. He had been the chief prosecutor of William Orr, the first United Irish martyr who was executed in 1797, while he was also the judge who granted habeas corpus to Wolfe Tone the following year. Lord Kilwarden was dragged from his carriage and brutally hacked to death, while dragoons which had been protecting him were pulled from their horses and piked gruesomely until the life left their bodies.
On witnessing this mayhem, Robert Emmett called off the rising to avoid any more bloodshed and immediately fled into hiding. It seems then that the romance of the story comes into its own, with the claim that Emmett moved his hiding place from Redfarm to Harold's Cross to be near his sweetheart. Such was the love he held for Sarah Curran, but is there any truth in this tale? And is it so obvious the mistake he made by not fleeing Ireland immediately?
Well, I think the key thing is that Emmett didn't want to escape. His mother was begging him to go to America and join up with his brother who was going to move there. But Emmett was determined to remain in the country. And people always put out that line about wanting to be near Sarah Curran. I really don't think that was the case. Emmett was so concerned in the aftermath of the failed rebellion that he wanted to make sure the other rebellions got to safety and that they weren't implicated. So when he went back to Harold's Cross, what he was actually doing was kind of masterminding the escape of the other rebels. And at times he was seeing Sarah Curran and passing her notes, but really it wasn't a romantic attachment that brought him back to Dublin. It was actually trying to, I suppose, look after his responsibilities as a leader.
So Robert Emmett was caught by the British and tried for treason, where he was condemned and sentenced to death by the presiding judge, the infamous Chief Justice Lord Norbury. But it was the harshness of this sentence and his sometimes haunting patriotic speech from the dock which is said to be the real legend of Robert Emmett.
The sentence passed on the leader of the 1803 uprising, according to most reports from the trial, was that Emmett was to be hung, drawn and quartered. But is the true legacy of this brave young and maybe foolish Irish patriot his great speech? Or is it a combination of both? Is he remembered as much for his horrific death as the proud oration he relayed to the court that day, as is recalled over 200 years later?
Well, see, I think the execution adds to it, but the reality is he actually wasn't hung, drawn and quartered. That's part of the myth, and that's part of the ballad, and bold Robert Emmett, he died with a smile, hung, drawn and quartered, that was my fate. But the reality is that he was just hanged and beheaded, that sentence was commuted. So it was just the normal punishment for treason at that time. But the real reason that he was remembered was because of the brilliance of the speech from the dock. It was seen as one of the great courtroom orations, one of the greatest ones in history. Abraham Lincoln studied it, memorized it growing up. It was required reading for all aspiring orators in Britain and America for the next 150 years. But also, I think the romance with Sarah Curran, the youthful idealism, everything that he represented, I think that captured the popular imagination, not just in Ireland, but in the wider world. That if Robert Emmett had been 70 years old and hadn't delivered a speech and hadn't a young, attractive girlfriend, he would be forgotten about now and the rebellion would be forgotten about. But because he captured the popular imagination, because of the romance, the idealism of his life, he became kind of an image that people could write their own history over him. So he became kind of the archetypal hero then for people who wanted a symbol of Irish resistance to British rule.
Was that speech tampered with since? Or is that the original form, the ones we find in history books?
Well, there were two people taking very close notes during the trial. So we pretty much have two fairly accurate versions. Now, we're not entirely sure about which one is more accurate than the other. Sometimes you have to it's like if you would have two people reporting on a Dáil debate or reporting on a speech that they would hear even in the present day. You're going to get slight discrepancies between them. We pretty much know from the government versions that it was a very impressive speech. We know the rough outline of the speech and we know what Emmett was attempting to say. There's some disagreement about parts of the lines, but overall we're pretty confident about the main arguments that Emmett was making.
And so our quick look at Rebel Robert Emmett draws to a close. But the last question that we'd have to ask is about the mystery surrounding the disappearance of his body. So this query was put to our interviewee, Dr. Patrick Wagan.
Well, everyone has their own theory, and I'm sure people listening to this show will be sending in their own ideas. It's one of those great mysteries. The body disappeared afterwards. He was hanged, beheaded. The body disappeared, and we don't know where it is. It could have been just put into a pit with some of the other prisoners. His family could have taken it and hidden it and buried it somewhere. People think maybe one of the churchyards that the family had connections in. You just don't know. You don't know whether it was hidden by the British. Yeats said if that was the intention, then the British failed because they in fact made all of Ireland his tomb. It may be that his family buried it somewhere. It may have just got lost.
One time when walking down a lane, as night was drawing nigh, I met a colleen with three flowers, and she more young than I. St. Patrick bless you, dear, said I, if you'll be quick and tame.
the place where you did find these flowers I seem to know so well. She took a flower and kissed it once and softly said to me, this flower I found in Thomas Street in Dublin Fair, said she. Its name is Robert Emmett, it's the youngest flower of all, and I keep it fresh beside my breast, though all the world should fall. She took a flower and kissed it twice and softly said to me, this flower comes from the Antrim hills outside Belfast, said she. The name I call it is Wolf Tone, the bravest flower of all, and I'll keep it fresh beside my breast, though all the world should fall. She took a flower and kissed it thrice and softly said to me, this flower comes from the Wicklow hills, its name is Dwyer, said she. And Emmett Tone and Dwyer I'll keep, for I do love them all, and I'll keep them fresh beside my breast, though all the world should fall. And I'll keep them fresh beside my breast, though all the world should fall.
Wherever Robert Emmett's body may lie, his memory lives on as much now as it did then. There have been many songs, stories and poetry written about this Irishman who would give his life for his country, about his brave, selfless deeds, his heroism, his strength and his resolve, his love for Sarah Curran and the tragic beauty of it all. There are many who have put pen to paper, so this Irish patriot is never forgotten, so the march of time doesn't cruelly leave his efforts behind. One such person was Robert Emmett's friend from Trinity College, the world-renowned Irish poet Thomas Moore, a man who understood more than most his academic colleague. This much-celebrated national poet recorded forever in Irish Melodies 1808 how much a small nation could have mourned for one of its bravest sons. Such respect are only held for a few. Oh, breathe not his name, let it sleep in the shade, where cold and unhonoured his relics are laid. Sad, silent and dark, be the tears that we shed, as the night dew that falls on the grass o'er his head. But the night dew that falls, though in silent it weeps, shall brighten with verdure the grave where he sleeps. And the tear that we shed, though in secret it rolls, shall long keep his memory green in our souls.
My lords, what have I to say why the sentence of death should not be pronounced upon me according to law? I have nothing to say that can alter your predetermination. Yes. Sentence was already passed before your jury was impaneled.
Yes.
I have much to say why my reputation should be rescued from the load of false accusation and calumny that have been heaped upon it. The man dies, but his memory lives. I wish that my memory may animate those who survive. While I look down with complacency upon the destruction of that perfidious government which upholds her dominion through blasphemy of the Most High.
Yeah, yeah.
A government which is steeled to barbarity by the cries of the widows and the tears of the orphans it has made. I have been accused of that importance in the efforts to emancipate my country as to be considered a keystone in the combination of Irishmen. You do me honor over much. There are men engaged in this conspiracy, my lord, who are not only superior to me, but even to your own conceptions of yourself. What, my lord, shall you tell me? That I am accountable for all the blood that has and will be shed in this struggle? Shall you tell me this? And must I be so very a slave as not to repel it? I do not fear to approach the omnipotent judge, to answer for the conduct of my whole life. And am I to be appalled and falsified by the mere remnant of mortality here? By you too, who, if it were possible to collect all the innocent blood that you have shed in your unhallowed ministry in one great reservoir, your lordship might swim in it. My lords, you are impatient for the sacrifice. Be impatient. I am going to my cold and silent grave. My race is run. I have but one request to make at my departure from this world. It is the charity of its silence. Let no man write my epitaph. For since no man who knows my motives dare now vindicate them, let not prejudice nor ignorance asperse them. Let them and me rest in obscurity and peace, and my tomb remain uninscribed until other times and other men can do justice to my character. When my country takes her place among the nations of the earth, then, and not till then, let my epitaph be written. I have done.
Words which have stood up through the test of time. Long after the original order was executed, they drew many other brave men and women to their cause. That was Liam Cansey with his recital of Patriot Robert Emmett's speech from the dock. And alas, as today's show draws to a close, we would like to finish with an appropriate song. This is the Dublin City Ramblers and Bold Robert Emmett.
The struggle was over, the boys were defeated. Surrounded with sadness and gloom, we were defeated and shamefully treated. And I, Robert Emmett, awaiting my doom. Hung, drawn, and quartered, sure that was my sentence. But soon I will show them no coward of mine. My crime was a love of a land I was born in. For a hero I've lived, and a hero I'll die. Bold Robert Emmett, the dark take me.
and with her I will sail far over the sea. But I was arrested and cast into prison, tried as a traitor, a rebel, a spy. But no one can call me a knave or a coward, for a hero I've lived and a hero I'll die. Bold Robert Emmett, the darling of Erin. Bold Robert Emmett, he'll die with a smile.
We'd like to thank you for listening to today's show. We're especially grateful to Dr. Patrick Wagan for contributing his expertise to today's programme, while we're also thankful to the musical talents of Paddy Riley, Johnny McAvoy and the Dublin City Ramblers, whose performances of Only Our Rivers Run Free, The Three Flowers and Bold Robert Emmett were used in the making of this programme. I'm Michael McGee.
And I'm Colm O'Neil. And we'd hope that you tune in again to join us soon, right here on History on Your Doorstep.